This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
See Live Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is brought to you by Burger King, the Cleveland Clinic, the Digital Transformation Unit, Janae's Uniform Center, RF Banking Trust, and Royal Star Assurance.
Welcome, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. I trust and hope that you are doing well. If you want to give us a call, you can call us today on any of the following numbers. You can call us on 323-6232. That's 323-6232 or 325-4316. 325-4316 or 325-4529. That's 325-4259. You can text us on 4224796. That's 4224796. Or you can WhatsApp me on 4393043. That's 4393043. We are live on Cable Bahamas, channel 969. That's the way my mother listens to the show. Or you can catch us on BTC Flow channel 612. That's BTC Flow channel 612. I have the great Laverne Gardner with me today. She's co-hosting with me today as we talk about some very interesting things in our country. Welcome, welcome, Laverne.
Hi, Zhivargo. It's always good to be here with you.
Yes, it's good to be here with you. You know, we just switch it up. I go on your show, you come on this show, and together we just make trouble, seems like, to me.
No. We make good conversation. And, you know, we cause people to think. That's what I want to say.
That's the aim always. Always the aim. So let me say a couple of things about the Bahamas Power and Light, former Bahamas Electricity Corporation. And you can agree with me or disagree with me if you wish, Laverne. You know, in our country, when we get irritated with you, a person, a thing, we can be really hard. We can be really harsh. We can sometimes, I think, be exaggerative in our criticism of the thing. But whatever we think about the Bahamas Power and Light, this much is true. As a general rule, we have available to us electricity, power, for the running of our private lives and for the commercial operations in this country. And it would not be possible to operate our nation at the level of economic activity that we do, at the level of social activity that we do, at the level of cultural activity that we do, if we did not have a reasonable provision of power in the country. We couldn't do it. So that responsibility belongs to Bahamas Power and Light. And quite frankly, they do, I quote, a reasonable job at providing that power supply to us. And they have for decades done so. We have had reliability issues. We have had issues related to cost. We have had issues related to load shedding at peak times of the year, especially in the summer. There's no question about that. And so can it be a better enterprise? Can it run more efficiently? Of course it can. But let's start off with this power company is critical to the ongoing functioning of the Bahamian society. Have I gotten anything out of the way yet, Laverne?
So far, I'm in agreement with you.
Okay. Now, it is also, though,
I like that you used reasonable.
Yeah, reasonable. That's what I mean. I would not, you know, honestly, I don't have any metrics to judge whether it is a best-in-class provider of power. I don't. My suspicion is it's not, that it's not. But I don't have the metrics that would say, well, if you're operating at this level of efficiency, you're operating at this level of productivity, et cetera, then you're in this class or that class or the other. I know that its cost is high and high among those in the Caribbean, and I mean, it may even be lower than some of our counterparts, but I don't know whether it's best in class. My suspicion is it's not, right? But here's what I do know. The Bahama Power and Light, former BEC, has been owned by the government of the Bahamas for all the time that it has been in operation. It therefore has been an instrument of politics in the Bahamas, where politicians have taken the liberty to use it to engage people, to employ people, to execute public policy in ways that they believed necessary and so forth. Up to 2003, it used to be on its books a profitable company. So anyone who's ever said it's never been a profitable company would not be accurate in saying that. Up to 2003, if you check its financial statements, audited financial statements, it used to be a profitable company. It ceased to be that in 2003. And it has not recovered since that time. And so, why it became a non-profitable company, it really might be, some might debate it. It seemed to be a decision in 2002, 2003, thereabouts, where one, the company cut its rate. So the government had promised to cut the rate. This was under the Christie administration. The government had promised to cut the rate, and it did. At the same time, though, it did some increases in salaries. And so I don't need to tell you what happens if your revenue shrinks and your cost goes up. There was some restructuring of some financial arrangements that I think in the end may have played a role in also increasing the outflows of the company. And so a number of things happened in that period of time to then bring it into a non-profitable situation. Then over time, I think the company's maintenance requirements, financing needs and all that, coupled with challenges collecting revenue or losing revenue because the economy itself was not performing as it used to, all those things combined to bring it to a place where it became an unprofitable company and it has not caught itself since. Okay? But this is not untypical of government-run operations. A monopoly, you would be a disaster as a monopoly not to make money. After all, you are the only provider of a thing, and you can charge whatever you want, right? So when BTC was the only provider of telecommunications in the country, an idiot would have had to run BTC in order for it to lose money. Okay? Now, you can, as a monopoly, though, lose money when politics comes into play. What do I mean by that? When government decides, oh, no, my costs have gone up, but I'm not passing that on to the public. Government decides, oh, you know what? I want to make a campaign promise, and I'm going to cut the rate, notwithstanding other costs are going up. Or government decides, you know what, we need to employ some people. Let me put 300 people in here, even though I don't need 300 people in the enterprise. And so when you look at government corporations, especially the ones that have to compete in market spaces, you cannot find a profitable one of them. If you could find one for me, Laverne, please happily name it.
Yeah, no.
It's very difficult. Very difficult. Yeah. Even, even the ones, even the government operations that have been semi-privatized, like Bank of Bahamas as an example, you find challenges with profitability, right? Now, BTC is profitable. Notwithstanding all the talks, et cetera, and what have you, BTC in a competitive environment remains profitable, but it's still semi-privatized. We always talk about, oh, the government private. The government owns 40-something percent. The Bahamian people own 49% of BTC. So it's still a, it's still a quasi-private entity, but it's pretty much run privately. The government don't go inside there and talk about, oh, no, fix the price of this, fix the price of that, because the arrangement for the privatization does not permit the government to do so. So BTC has ran into, not BTC, BPL has ran into issues, some of its issues, a significant number of its issues relate to how it is handled by the government as its owner on behalf of the people of the Bahamas. Significant issues relate to that. A bulk of that relates to how it's been operated and maintained and capitalized over the years in order to ensure that it could be a modern, efficient, effective operation, which is challenging when, again, your owner is the government. It's challenging. So as I listen to this row between the government and the opposition over Wärtsilä, the row between the government and the opposition is not what intrigues me. The row between the government and the opposition is a row about, well, y'all mess it up and y'all were there. So that's the Minister's administration. And the Minister's administration's folk, no, y'all mess it up because y'all didn't continue what we did when we were in office. So that's a standard, typical, not surprising row. What does surprise me, though, is how inconclusive, unclear the information we are getting from the people who run BPL. These are technical people. These are not politicians. If you are the CEO, the COO, the CFO, you are not a politician. Even if you're the chairman of the board of BPL, if you get political or you get my political, if your utterances seem to be an attempt to provide cover for, provide a justification for a political explanation, or meaning an explanation provided by a political personality or policymaker, I can understand that, because as a chairman of a board, you have been appointed by a government to represent their interest. But when you are the CEO, CFO, the COO of a company, your job is to represent the company. And so your information should be information that speaks with clarity to the affairs and state of the company. I even advised at one time, chairman of BPL, I said, you know what, listen, man, stay out of the political fray. Let the political people defend their policies. You defend the strategy of the company, what it's seeking to do. Provide people with excellent information about what is being done, what is the case. And that way you stay out of the political fray. So we get an explanation from our prime minister about the Wärtsilä engines at BPL. Significant investment made, over $100 million. In seven engines, right, to generate electricity. We heard our prime minister essentially say they never worked or never worked properly. And then he indicated that, well, they never were able to use all seven engines because of the faulty building in which the engines were housed. Now, prior to the prime minister...
I think we need to go back even before the prime minister said what he said.
Well, here, you can weigh in, but here's what I was going to say about that. Prior to the prime minister saying that, several interviews were done with the CEO of EPL. Several, the current CEO. In none of those interviews did the CEO ever mention any restraints on the use of those engine generators because of the buildings. The building they house, it's at the building they are housed in. Never one time. In the course of a whole speech before the Parliament of the Bahamas during the course of the budget debate, neither the Prime Minister was Minister of Finance, nor the Minister of Public Works responsible for BPL ever mentioned any such challenge. Now the CEO says, well, we cannot run all seven engines at the same time because it's risky, because they're sprawling in the building that houses these engines when all seven engines are run. Now, sprawling is you have falling concrete from the structure. Of course, that could be dangerous because somebody could get hit with that. It could drop and that damage equipment and so forth. But he says you can't run because they're risky. And that begs a lot of questions for me. So before I go on any further, you go ahead.
What I wanted to say is during this whole back and forth, we heard the CEO say that five of those Wärtsilä engines were running, who were down for maintenance.
Right.
We didn't get any details at that point that, you know, it was anything other than two were down for maintenance.
Well,
the concern about the building at that point. We
right.
then go into what the Prime Minister said about the Wärtsilä engines never running or not running properly. And it was a bad deal and all such and everything. And then after that, we now have the CEO coming to bring clarity to what the Prime Minister said.
Right. Right. Now, and so the question is, go ahead.
So now we have all of these other things introduced into the conversation, so to speak. So I don't know, and, you know, this is just me in my head, to kind of, I guess, in a way, substantiate maybe what the Prime Minister had said to a certain point, because we had two very different accounts of these Wärtsilä engines up to that point.
Mm.
So now we have the CEO explaining what the Prime Minister meant. And maybe that's a typical thing, but I found that odd. But okay. He explained to the best, I guess, that he could, of what perhaps maybe the Prime Minister was speaking to. And so now we understand about spoiling and the integrity of the power station at Clifton Pier, and, you know, the vibrations and all of that that could happen if all seven of these engines run the same time. And that's, you know, it's dangerous. So...
Yeah.
At no point it seems as if that's going to happen, or it's only going to happen under very extreme circumstances.
Well, that's my understanding. Yes, and I think that's fairly clear from what was said. But yes, here is what I understand. Because, Francis, you said that the CEO said that two of the engines were down for maintenance. What I understand is, in off-peak periods, it is never the intent to run all seven engines, because you have to have a maintenance schedule for the engines. So you run them in rotation so that two are always offline so that you can do the maintenance and keep up with the maintenance schedule. So it was never the intent in off-peak periods, which is about 9 months of the year, for you to run those all at the same time. Never. So the notion that somehow you should have been running these engines all seven at the same time, all the time, is really not sensible. It never isn't necessary. Maybe in the summer and peak periods you can or you want to. But I also understand that the building, my understanding is that this building had issues long before the engines were put in them. That, and someone said and used the words that the building was condemned by Public Works, right? But I find that surprising because Public Works is the ministry responsible for BPL. You're going to put Waxilla engines in a building that you condemned? So I find that interesting. But in any event, so the sprawling was happening even before that. So I'm told if you turned the fan on, you would have had some sprawling taking place. Now, sprawling.
The keynote did indicate that, though, and what I read did indicate that if there were problems existing prior to engines going in there, in that building.
Right. But now, let's be clear, though. Government has many buildings with sprawling taking place. Whether they are schools or other buildings, they have sprawling happens. And so you can do the necessary to address it if you don't have a substantial structural issue where the building itself might collapse. Sprawling happens. It happens over time. It happens sometimes from defective construction. So that can happen. But if you have sprawling that can be triggered by a fan, you could have sprawling that could be triggered by five engines being used. These engines didn't get put in BPL last month, or 6 months ago, or 1 year ago, or 2 years ago, you know. These buildings been there for a little over 2 years, as far as I recall, these engines. So you've been running these engines all that time. You've been running these engines, and it's the explanation from the CEO that the engines were not ever running seven at a time because of the building or because of the maintenance schedule. Has that explanation ever entered the public fray?
I don't, honestly, Zhivargo, after reading and listening to what the CEO said, it seems like it's a combination of things now why all seven of them didn't run. It's the building, it's the maintenance, it's the fact that some of them, there was issue with the proper pretreatment and the heating, stuff not being in place. So now it seems that there are a myriad of issues of why all seven of them never run.
Yeah, except though, you had a conversation with the CEO though, about why five of the engines were running of the seven. And he said what the reason was.
Who were down for maintenance.
Exactly. This additional explanation about, he didn't say, you know, if you read what he said, he doesn't say in the article that I read from The Guardian, he doesn't say, not to my reading, that the engines aren't run seven at a time because of the building. He said it's a risk to do so. That's not the same thing. He didn't say, oh, we only run five at a time because if we run seven of these at a time, there's a risk and we therefore don't run seven at a time. He said doing so is a risk because of these issues. But he did say that they aren't running seven because they are on a maintenance schedule for two. See, why this is, and we're going to take a break and come back to it, but why this is important is, This is all about how the public should understand what is causing the billing that they are having, and what is causing the load shedding that they are having. Now, if you didn't have load shedding when you were running five of these engines all along for the last couple of years, because we didn't have any load shedding last year, but the year before that, why is it an issue now? Because you're still only running five engines in the same building. You were running the same engines last time, and the year before that, when your bills were lower. Why are they higher now? Same engines in the same building. So what are the buildings and the number of engines have to really do with why you're load shedding and why you have an increase in billings for consumers? That's the basic question. When we come back, we'll look at it some more. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
The car. The lady run into me, marsh the car.
I hope she had insurance.
If she had insurance, she hop out, pull out her phone, pull out the Royal Star Assurance app, and bang, she was on a video call with an RSA rep, sending pictures of her damage, my damage, filing a claim on the spot.
For real? Our insurance have that kind of app?
You gotta go to RSA for that.
Download the RSA app today, or visit rsabahamas.com to submit your claim online. Live chat available weekdays 9 to 5.
Are you dreaming of the perfect summer getaway? Apply for a debt consolidation or personal loan to win an airline ticket to Paris, Miami, or New York. Win up to $2,500 in cash and more. For details, call 356-7764 for Nassau, 602-681-1 for Freeport, 823-4374 for Abaco.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Everybody, come take my hand, We'll walk this road together, through the storm, whatever weather.
Back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. I'm here with the great Laverne Gardner. And we're talking in this first instance about BPL. Just before we go further, Laverne, there's a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Hey, good afternoon, Zhivargo.
Hi, how are you doing?
Fine, thank you. Good afternoon to you, guys, and happy new month.
Thank you. Same to you.
I have a question that's on my mind. What the generators that came in, did they just go and purchase them and brought them in? Or was there a consultation where BPL and Wattzilla and BEC were all involved in a negotiation of getting those generators?
Well, firstly, the generators were purchased from Wattzilla. Okay, so the fact of the consultation with them is a given because they purchased them from Wattzilla.
Okay, now right. I asked that because I'm thinking about the building that they're saying, you know, is a risk to run all seven because of, the building is not, so that's my thing. Did Wattzilla come over, checked out the building to see, because they would know what kind of vibration comes from these generators. So that's my question.
That's a great question. I have, what I understand is, it's a great question. What I understand is that there was a technical assessment done of the, well, let's put it like this, one of the buildings down there, and that some determinations were made that it was, I think they said, okay. But then there was what, Zilla brought some people down to take a look at things. And then they found that some parts of it had issues, which they then did some work to shore up. I understand that the foundations of the thing was actually, like the platform of the thing was actually redone to ensure that the engines could be, what have you. I think they did some work to the roof and what have you. But the answer to my knowledge is yes, some things were done. The consultations were held and some things were done. That's my understanding.
Okay, because I'm curious. I'm still trying to draw a line between what's going on with the generators, all seven not being able to run all at one time because of the building, and what the Prime Minister says about them not being able to run good at all to begin with. I'm trying to figure out if it's the building the problem or the generators the problem. I'm trying to draw a line to see where it all connects, you see? Well, and that's why I'm asking about the steadiness of the building.
Well, our understanding is there ain't no issue with the generators running. They are running. That's a fact, right? And they are running in that building, right? And they have been for years now running in that building. My understanding is that having taken Watzilla out of the service contract of those engines, Watzilla, in servicing the engines, also had liability if anything went wrong with those buildings. That's why the people who service those engines were actually Watzilla's employees. They were not BPL's employees. They were hired by Watzilla. They were trained by Watzilla. Bahamians, mind you, most of them, trained by them to service those engines. And Watzilla knew if anything went wrong with those engines, they would be liable. And so that's why they paid such careful attention to it.
That's the understanding that I got. You understand? But all right, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We have another call on the line. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you.
Hey, Minister, how you doing? Pop here.
Hey, Pop, how you doing? My long time no hear from.
Rachel, always listening. Good day, Miss Gardner. You know, when I listen to this whole thing, it sounds like from the time this government changed, the New Day government come into power, I think if it was an issue, we should have already dealt with them. Mm. 2 years, a year and a half, we should have already dealt with them.
Especially a problem on a building, right?
Yeah, that's the simplest part of it.
Yeah.
If they had any questions about the machine, they should have done dealt with that.
Mm.
I don't know no other way to say it. The Prime Minister get intelligent people trying to make sense. A comment made by him or his office, by him, was confusing.
Mm.
This whole thing is confusing, and it's not bad. I think if it was the Prime Minister private business, he wouldn't have cost himself $107 million or whatsoever the cost is on the Bahamian people. These politicians need to stop their foolishness. They're trying to score political points about who do this and what they do the last time and what ain't working. Then they get these intelligent people, CEOs and others, coming back and trying to make sense of what they're saying. They need to stop this political witch hunt. I don't know if it's really a witch hunt, but this whole thing we're trying to blame, use the government. We give you the chance to run this government. Come on, all this foolishness about who did this. We don't want to know that right now with this BPL thing. Because the big question is, why are light bills so high? And then you're talking about the machines and stuff. Okay, load shedding and light bill high. Why they don't make sense out of that for us? Why they don't try to help us people who might be as smart as them, dumbing it down so we can understand? Tell us simply, or Minister, if you could, tell us simply, why are light bills so high? Why going triple up? Yeah, we never going to pay our light bill in full sum of us. But from $400 or $300 to $1,200 or $1,300, my God. What decision? Is it a decision made by Prime Minister Davis, Simon Wilson, and all of them to stop the what they had, the hedging agreement, what they had from the former government? a little bit disappointed, not a little bit, big time disappointed with Brother Davis. He knows what it is for poor people to go through things. He's one of the people who's to be helping people. Now he's in a position as the Prime Minister and the Minister of Finance to fix it. And all he can do is point fingers. It's a national disgrace. I'm disappointed with Prime Minister Davis. He's supposed to try to fix this problem rather than pointing fingers, political points, while we are just suffering. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Pop. Appreciate it. We have another caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Good day, Mr. Laing. How you doing, man?
Hey, I'm right here, my friend. How are you?
Wonderful. Yeah, you and the lady, as Papa said, but you have to say, but you and the lady was right on target, and the lady was asking the right questions.
Mm.
You see, if my memory serves me correct, like you said, Mr. Laing, those bases were reconstructed prior to those engines going in there. Because the engines of that nature, see, I'm a former power technician at BTC. We basically had to deal with similar engines and stuff like that. So the main object of the engines, brand new engines being installed, is the base. It don't really affect the building as such. If those buildings were made to get to that point, it's for maintenance on the maintenance staff. And what really affects the engines are the base that they're on. And those engines don't run like the old generators. Those generators are very quiet, and they on that base, they have absorbers on them to minimize the brand new whatever engines try fuel. The first thing that was noticed was the Prime Minister was there was that it was a problem because the generators weren't constructed for the tri fuel. Well, we debunked that because we know we don't use LNG, and diesel costs $8 a gallon. And the only fuel that we ever use in the country with BPL was bunker C. So they pushed that one aside. They mentioned too much for that. You said the contract was stopped by the Progressive Liberal Party, where the Wasilla technicians was doing their maintenance of the engines in the event something went wrong. I call it a turnkey. That is what they do when you spend that kind of money. They send their technicians, they with BPL technicians, and every step of the way those foreign guys install those engines, BPL technicians are there watching. When they are done in their maintenance contract, their warranty, what they do is they call it a turnkey, then they turn the engines over to the Bahamians. So the Bahamians could be satisfied that once we're satisfied, we take over the engine. Brave David, however, shut the contract off. You understand, man? They terminated the contract.
But you can tell me
they go through all of that, but like, you know, something is wrong with those engines. That's impossible.
Can I ask you a question, please?
Huh?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can barely hear you.
Because I don't know why. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, you sound better.
Okay, I'm so glad you called, because I was thinking the same thing. It's the base of the engines, and these engines, I understand, are on absorbers. So I always thought it was the base of the engine. I can't imagine you having a house for an engine, seven of them, and that if five of them ran or seven of them ran, you would have an upward collapse challenge with a building? Maybe some story, but
Oh, no. Them foreign boys don't work like that. I worked with them many years at BTC all over, installing and doing power plants. I worked with them. Mm. They work with specs, buddy.
Mm.
Now, the key thing, Mr. Laing, that you, the lady, Papa, and everybody is missing, you know.
Mm.
What we never bought 7 Wasilla engines, you know. I know they forget this, but Mr. David, them forget this. We bought 5.
Okay.
2 of the engines that are rotating down there is private.
Ah, really?
2 of them are private.
Really?
Yes, that's what the CEO say. that we, and Mr. Leslie Miller, that we, BEC is being sold energy from two private engines down there.
Well, that's true. I understand that.
But,
No, I understand that there are some private generators of electricity.
They're private generators. So Philip probably possibly only have five generators down there, and two are private. So, in essence, Wasilla never runs their five generators all at once. They probably run three along with the two private ones. I just throw that tidbit out there.
Okay. All right. Okay, I appreciate it. Thank you. We got to pay our respects to our sponsors once again, ladies and gentlemen. We got to get it in. So we'll come back. We'll be back after this break. You're listening to Z Live.
Like the margin loan facility at RF, I can use my government bonds, company shares, and other investments to access cash when I need it. At a low interest rate of 7.5%, flexible repayment terms, and a 48-hour approval time, I can easily get the cash I need for travel, home renovations, or to purchase additional shares. This is just one of the ways RF keeps making for me. Learn more about the RF margin loan at rfgroup.com.
When faced with an illness like cancer, we band together, and we at Cleveland Clinic in Florida have your back. From advanced cancer treatments to extra safety measures at all of our locations, we're with you on this journey. For every infusion and follow-up, for every step of the way, for every care in the world, Cleveland Clinic in Florida. Get the care you need when and where you need it. To learn more or connect with a local representative, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. I'm here with Laverne Gardner. Laverne, you know, I know the caller called and said that Wasilla, that the BPL didn't purchase seven engines from Wasilla. But while I am aware that BPL does have privately generated power, I am reliably informed that BPL actually purchased seven engines from Wasilla. Okay. I'm reliable.
Here's the thing. The thing, Zhivargo, and I mean, we're getting some really good information and questions. But at the end of the day, the issue still remains the same. When people look at their power bill, they want to know, why am I paying so much?
Is it, and is that related to sprawling in the building? Is it related to five of the seven engines? It can't be related to five of the seven in running, because if you run more engines,
it would have,
you'd have, I assume you'd have more cost because you use more fuel, right?
Correct. So, and let's just say that at no point really was seven engines running. Maybe, like you said, at peak time, when you really need. It would be dangerous to have all seven engines running all at the same time and not being maintained properly, right?
Right.
So we're going to say that having five of those engines running isn't the issue. So what is the issue when people are now seeing their bill? They're experiencing load shedding every day, almost every day, and the bills are high. And that is what the Bahamian people want. More than anything, they want to be able, even if they don't like the explanation, what they want to know and understand is, why is my bill so exorbitant? What is the reason? And the going back and forth, you did this. No, you did that. No, you've been in the bad building. No, well, we, and all of that. is not helping.
Yeah,
because no one is coming out and saying, okay, the reason the bill is so high is because we are only using, what is it, LFO fuel or HFO or whatever. And because of that, this is why it's nobody's saying that. Instead, what we have is a back and forth about whether hedging would have caused the bills not to be high or the engines weren't working properly to start with. And so you have all these different dynamics introduced into the situation, but still we are not getting an answer.
So let me give you a little bit of private information, personal information, Laverne, right? So I have a three bedroom house. It may be about 3,500 square feet, right? Downstairs, I run a ductless unit, air conditioned all day. I'm talking about all day. I run that. I start that maybe 7 o'clock in the morning, running that until about 9-10 o'clock at night. Upstairs, I have a central air, and I have to run it in the summer because it is just too hot, right? I mean, I guess it's too hot. So do you know what my highest bill was in the highest usage of my plate? This is in 3-point grand bahama. You want to hear what my highest bill was?
What is it? $440. And that's when you're running the central
and everything else inside the house. $440. You know what my lowest bill was? $114.92. All right, this for the whole year. This for the year, for 2023. All right? This is a Grand Bahama Power Company.
Okay, so off air, you're going to have to explain to me because I'm too embarrassed to tell you with 1 month of running my ductless unit in my bedroom alone, my bill has tripled. And so clearly I have a problem with this unit that I have. It's garbage. But in any event, I don't want to get into that takeaway from BPL. But the point, I understand the point that you were making.
Is that we're talking about two power companies, and I think they are having two different experiences. Right? Two different experiences in the way they are maintained, managed, et cetera, is my point. Right? Now, I'm not saying people in Grand Bahama don't have high power bills. But if you ask the people at Grand Bahama Power Company what's driving it, ain't be no sprawling building and them kind of things. It might be the fuel surcharge. It might be something else. But you get an explanation. You might like it. You might agree with it. But you get an explanation. What you are asking is, what's the explanation for the shedding and for the billings? And so far, do you have an explanation?
No.
Okay, that's the point.
After everything is said in that, after all of the finger pointing, the average customer does not have an explanation, and that's why I say even if you don't like the explanation, but sometimes you get an explanation and you don't like it. That's fine. But the point is to have an explanation. There really has not been an explanation, even with all these other factors being introduced.
Now, here's what is interesting. This is off of BPL's website, right? This is off the website. This is the statement I'm going to read is off the website and providing information on Station A under the heading State of the Art Sustainable Power. It says, this is from an article in The Guardian, mind you. Say Station A at BPL's Clifton Pier Power Station was completed and began pumping power to the grid in December 2019. The total investment in Station A was $96.8 million, and the project was funded through a loan and insurance proceeds. Station A is the last single power plant ever built in the history of BCBPL, and it was built in record time, less than 9 months. This is still quoting from it. The station features 7-watt 50 DF engines designed to give high output with fuel flexibility, low emissions, efficiency, and reliability. These highly automated engines can burn light fuel oil, natural gas, or heavy fuel oil, and can smoothly switch between fuels whilst operating, providing the same output regardless of the fuel. Each engine is rated at 18.85 megawatts. That means we have just under 132 megawatts of state-of-the-art, high-efficiency, low-cost power that will become the replacement baseload generation available for BPL, New Providence operations, and will leapfrog the company into the forefront of power generation technology. That's the Wattzilla engines in the sprawling building on off of BPL's website.
Well, clearly that's not happening. Something isn't happening. Something is not right.
No, well, but they say, but they're saying is we don't have no issues with Wattzilla engines. So we have to look elsewhere for an explanation about the cost and reliability then. We have to take a break for news. When we come back, we'll read your texts, you'll take your calls, and talk some more. I'm here with Laverne Gardner. You're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. We'll be back after this break.
Everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm. Whatever weather, cold or warm. Send me know that you're not alone. Holla if you feel like you make it down the same road.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm not afraid, to take a stand, Everybody, come take my hand, We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. I trust and hope that you are doing well. I'm here with Laverne Gardner of Mixed Fuse, and we are talking about EPL at the moment. Laverne, I want to read something for you. As you asked the question, why are our bills going up? Did you not? You asked that question, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Can I give you the answer? Okay. Yeah. So this is on the government's website. It was dated October 5th, 2022. And it says, today, BPL is announcing an increase in the monthly fuel surcharge, said Prime Minister Davis. For a large majority of BPL customers who consume less than 800 kilowatt hours, the fuel charge is increasing by 2 cents per kilowatt, which will result in an increase in the increase this quarter of less than $20 per month. If your current monthly bill is $182 or less, you fall in this category. For those who consume more, the increase will be $4.03 per kilowatt hour, right? Now, here's what I want you to hear. He said, speaking of the Prime Minister, the increase in rate will be phased over a period of time in order to meet the rising and fluctuating cost in fuel. BPL will provide additional details of these changes, which phase in over time. Listen to this. The bottom line is that monthly bills will go up over the next several quarters before they begin to come down in 12 to 18 months. This is October 5th. This is October 5th, 2022, the statement came out. This is now August 1, right? So we only several months into the 12 to 18 months, the Prime Minister said that there'll be phased increases in the rates for people. So we know where the rate increase is coming from. And he said what is causing it. He says, this is to address rising fuel costs, rising and fluctuating costs in fuel. That's what the Prime Minister said. Are you clear now?
Yes.
Okay.
I was listening intently, so he didn't say anything about the engines.
No.
He didn't say anything about the squalling.
No.
Okay.
But more importantly, he forecasted this.
Yeah, he did.
He forecasted it. He said so. In fact, when I did the show, I said so, right? Because I went through the numerous detailed phasing in rates. We have a call on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Yes, good afternoon, Mr. Laing.
Hi, how you doing?
I'm all right. I listened to the part you just read.
Okay.
And even for what I don't... one time ago, they said it would take $4 million to rectify those engines. But those engines, as from what you just said, are capable of being able to run with a little change, or just, it seems like, switching a switch.
No, but, sir, the engines are running today. They are running today.
It.
Okay.
To run on the different gases they are spoken about.
Right.
Sometime but last month, I think they said it'll take about $4 million to rectify all this. Now, read where they said these things could run off of these things.
Yes,
and
that is true.
And that didn't mention any change in our modification.
That is
somebody
true.
At BPL is playing games
no,
to make money
no.
or get kickbacks.
No, hold on. Listen to when I was given some guidance about the technical realities of this, what I was told was that there is a purification system that could be used to help those engines run more effectively, because running those engines off of the light fuel that they are running the engines off is not the most efficient. It works the engines harder, and it costs more problems for the seals and all that kind of stuff. And my understanding is that BPL actually acquired this purification system, but it's not in use. That's what I'm told. I don't know if that's so, but I'm told there is a purification system that could be used to help it run more efficiently off of fuel that is better for the engines than the current fuel being used to run the engines.
Given what you just said, then where are the things that to make the engines run better and cheaper?
Good question.
I'm a person that is in business, and my electricity bills are killing me. And when I lose my business, I can't go to BPL and say, look, man, this helped kill me, all these high bills. And you all have not done anything about it. You're killing the poor man with this thing, man. We can't wait. Listen, we got to pay VAT. We got to pay business license. You got to pay the garbage man. You got to pay this thing. You got to pay the next thing. You got to pay the business license. Or it's salaries. You got to replenish. And now here you go with your bill, and you don't give two heats. And you just, like it's a normal thing, carry on smartly. Just carry on smartly. How you make it is your business. I was laying down last night trying to figure out how to commit a crime to make money.
No, man. Don't do it.
I am telling you the facts of life.
I understand, brother, but don't do it.
What I can do to make some money to catch up with my bills. Because the government don't care. BPL don't care.
What am I
supposed to do? A man who wakes all his life, lose my days behind these people?
Stay out of jail, bro. Okay? Stay out of jail. But thanks for calling. So, Laverne, let me give people the details in case you didn't know. This is what the schedule is. Between October 1st and November 30th, 2022, new charges, $12.05. Between December 1st and February 28th, 2023, new charges, $14.05. 14 cents, 14 and a half cents, sorry, 12 and a half cents, 14 and a half cents. Between March 1st and May 31st, 2023, new charges, 16 and a half cents. Between June 1 and August 31st, which is where we are now, 2023, new charges, $18.05. This was from $0.12 to $0.18. Okay, from October to now. Okay, that's a 6 increase. Between September 1 and November 30th, 2023, new charges, 18 and a half cents. So that's basically the same. And then in December between December 1 and February 24th of next year, it'll go down to 17 cents. That's for anyone using less than 800 kilowatts per hour per month. If you're using more than 800 kilowatts per hour per month, between October 1 and November 30th, 2022, new charge, 14.8 cents. Between December 1 and February 28, 2023, new charge, 19.1 cents. Between March 1 and May 31st, 2023, new charge, 23.3 cents. Between June 1 and August 31st, 2023, that's now 27.6 cents. That means that's a 10 plus cents increase over that same period of time per kilowatt hour. And between September 1, November 3rd to November 30th, 2023, new charge, 25 cents. So it starts to go down. And December 1, 20, so between December 1 and February, what new charge should be 18 cents. It goes down again. That's the schedule.
So can we then say the explanation of why bills are so high is because of this increase to offset the fluctuating prices of fuel?
Yes, according to the Prime Minister's explanation, and that's why
he gave this explanation last year in October.
Last year, October, and remember that was when the debate was happening. That had the hedge fuel, the hedging taken place, you would have avoided.
We would have to have done this fluctuations.
That's right. That was the debate. So this says
so all of this other stuff is just smoke and mirrors, really.
Well, what it is it doesn't explain the increase. That's
no,
for sure.
It didn't. It certainly did not. And the average consumer in New Providence, I wonder what their average consumption is per month. Probably more than 800, eh?
Well, you know, it stands to reason that while you may have been in your off-peak period, you've been using, in non-summer period, been using 800 or less, the average person maybe, when summer comes.
And especially, this has been the hottest summer every day. The heat indices is up in the triple digits, so, yeah.
Exactly. This text says the generation source is from multiple suppliers, not specifically the Wattzilla engines. There are contracts for rentals of other generation sources, namely two different companies. Yes, I'm aware of that. I am aware that. So that you know, folks, I don't know about the two companies. So I only could speak to what I know. I know that there is another company that generates at least 30 kilowatts of DPL's power. So they supply DPL with power. That could be true. It may well be true that there are two others, but I only can confirm what I know. And so that is true. And the balance is then generated by DPL. This text says, great show as usual. BPL should be sued for what they are doing to people equipment in their house. I just moved in my house, first bill, 65, second bill, 85, third bill, 185. Boy, I tell you, only the main bomb is happy 50th. I can tell you one thing. If you sue BPL, you're suing yourself. Because whatever BPL has to cough up to do things, it has to cough up from the public coffers or from the consumers who pay their bills. So you don't sue BPL and win. Some of us win, all of us lose if you sue BPL. Okay. This is what Leslie Miller was referring to, not that someone else owns the two engines. Okay, I got you. I got you. All right. So Luverne, that's the things. I don't think we have any more, we're not in the dark anymore about what is happening, right?
No.
We're
not.
Okay, that's what I...
Let's not get caught up in the weeds. Let's go back, pay attention, read. And there's, of course, no way to prepare for a really high bill, but this was coming from October of last year.
This tax, as we all know, the reason why they are running off the current fuel type is because of the contracts with Focal that help by specific specific Bahamians. I am not sure about that because my understanding is while Focal may be involved with some generation, Focal doesn't supply BPL its fuel. Shell North America does. Focal only provides the distribution of that fuel to the family islands. Okay, so let's be clear about that. I've been through this. I've done this search, okay? So that narrative is not the correct narrative. Texas, Mr. Laing, we pay Sun Oil for fuel and to use their engines. No, we don't. To use their engines. Say Sun Oil replaced the Greco generators with their engines. That is true. Please go and visit Blue Hill Power Station to see for yourself. No, I know that is true. I know that they provide some generation, but I'm saying the notion that the fuel supplied to BPL is supplied by Sun Oil, that is not true. That's supplied by Shell North America, and that is not Focal or Sun Oil. It's Texas. When coming into power, I thought the government said no new taxes. The other company is Sun Oil, yeah, somebody says. Texas, fluctuate means irregular rise and fall. Where's the price decrease? Yeah, that's a good question. Sure, right?
That's happen next year, the end of 2024.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. You won't. Mind you, when I interviewed Donovan Moxie in 2018 or 19, I think it was, Donovan Moxie told me that the lower fuel prices due to the hedge was only guaranteed for 1 year. And then they would have to look at the circumstances in the new tranche and see what the new hedging facilities would be. So he said that. And so once you got rid of the hedge or you didn't use the hedge, then you were open to the fluctuations in the marketplace. And it seems like the fluctuations in the marketplace were trending upward for 12 to 18 months. And so now you get caught in that upward trend and won't recoup until later on. Or at least won't recover until later on. Right? So you gotta do some things in your household to try to help level life out for yourself is, I guess, the only option you have.
What option? It's unbearably hot, and that's not, you know, saying that because you're trying to be fancy. You know, people are already unplugging everything. Oh, when I leave, unplug this, I turn this off from the breaker. And so you hear these stories all of the time, and still they're faced with the kind of bills, seemingly insurmountable bill.
No, but if you're in a very hot climate, unplugging can only take you some of the way if you still have to use air conditioned ACs and all that kind of stuff. But what the truth is, you have to be able to substitute some of your supplies. It takes an investment. I'm not saying everybody can do it, but you have to be able to substitute some of your supplies with alternative, less costly providers, equipment. That's really the reality. Like for me, I swear by those ductless units. Swear by them. They are absolutely energy efficient. Absolutely. And they put out good air conditioning. People walk inside my house and they say, well, boy, I need to feel good. And I'm in a thing all day. I have to, right? And it's covering at least 1,500 to almost 2,000 square foot of space downstairs. Right? And of course, you know, I swear by some propane alternative sources of equipment too, whether it's the stove or the dryer or otherwise, because they too are more cost effective, right? And I have none of them old bulbs in my house. I only have LED bulbs in my house. I've done all the things that I think I could try to do at the moment to try and help, and it has helped. And so, like I said, it takes some money up front, but it was worth it over time for me.
Right.
You know, so you just...
Well, I agree 100% with you. I think that in our case, you know, as I indicated earlier, that we just have the most garbage docus unit ever, because outside of that, my bill every month is very manageable. And I'm one of those who, while I could not afford solar, I have a gas stove, gas dryer, gas water heater. So once I don't turn this AC on, my bill is really very much under the low 100.
How old is the AC?
Boy, Zhivargo, that's a good question. I don't know.
No, it matters. It matters. They're not all equal.
I don't know. Yeah.
They're not all.
And that's why I said that. I honestly, genuinely think it is this unit that we have.
Yeah.
Because other than that, I really don't have any issues barring the overall increase that everybody received, in Grand Bahama. But other than that, I had no, real issues.
Yeah. It may well be that ductless unit, because of course all equipment have energy use readings, and they're not all as made. And so sometimes too, if the installation is a certain way, you can have leakage, right? And I talk by leakage, I mean in terms of the actual heat, and that makes the system work harder, and then use energy and so forth. So on any number of things matter, but I could tell you, I do not turn off my ductless until 10, 11 o'clock at night. And I'm talking about every day. That's not even just in the summer. That's every day.
And you have that running from the morning?
From 7 o'clock in the morning till I go to bed. And I have one in my den, but it's... for some reason, they tell me the board must have burnt or something like that. And so I have to get that replaced. But I didn't bother to replace it, because the one in the living room sends the cool in the den. So, it makes a difference doing something other than relying on BPL and them to save your soul by lower rates, because it just don't happen effectively enough. Anyway, we'll continue to... So at least we have clarity today about why the bill is high, right? Now, in terms of why the load shedding is happening, I don't think we have any clarity about that.
No.
I don't know, but I will tell you what I'm told. I'm told that running those Wattzilla engines on that fuel that they are running on has resulted in higher maintenance issues and challenges for the engines. So that maybe now between them and the other engines, you're not getting the amount of generation to deal with this peak period that we're having at this exceptional heat. And therefore, then you're load shedding because you just can't put out enough power to accommodate all the requirements of the society given what is taking place this summer. So maybe that's it. But again, we don't have a full explanation for that. All right. So we can take a break, Laverne. And when we come back, I can ask you, man, what's going on in the country with all this sexual assault? When we come back, we talk about it. I'm going to have an extensive conversation with a psychiatrist about this, but I just wanted us to... Something's going on. When we come back from the break, you're listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I'm here with Laverne Gardner of Mixed Views. And when we come back, we'll talk about it. What's going on? We'll be back after this break.
Shop early to get your uniforms and get Janae's Uniform Centers Buy 4, Get 1 free sale. pre-monogrammed and regular school shirts, dry fit and cotton polos, jumpers, skirts, boys' long and short pants, PE shorts, underclothes, tights, socks, neckties, belts, sleeping mats, hair accessories, and character work desk. Get 50% off backpacks and raincoats. Buy four school shirts, get one free. Buy two skirts, jumpers, or pants, get the third 50% off. Need embroidery and monogramming done? Visit Janae's Uniform Center early. Beat the back-to-school rush. Janae's Chesapeake Road back-to-school special. Restrictions apply. Tell them.
Tired of paying too many bills and loan payments each month?
Shrink your monthly debt payments down to one easy payment with our debt consolidation loan.
It also has a built-in savings that pays you 5% interest.
Inquire about our debt consolidation loans today.
Call 356-7764.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand, come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live, I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. So glad that you could join us here today on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM on this beautiful Tuesday afternoon. I'm here with Laverne Gardner, the host of Mixed Views, and we're here talking about, among other things, DPL. We have a call on the line, Laverne, so let's take that. Go ahead, caller, we're listening to you. Hi, go ahead, caller, I'm listening to you. Hello, go ahead, caller. Okay, we seem to not have them. Laverne, somebody texted me to say this. Not all ductless are equal. Some garbage sear are being sold here. We should make illegal sear below a certain level. I don't know what sear means, but... So also the right BTU for room size is needed as it can keep the AC running constantly, recycling. You got that?
All of
got,
that.
Yeah. So you
this is like, this is, you know, crazy to me, honestly.
Yeah.
And I'm at the point where, you know, you turn it on because you absolutely have to.
When I get the Freeport, we're gonna connect me, you, and Mark, and then we're gonna look at mine, and then look at yours, and then we can see.
Yeah, we
do that. We have a caller on the line. Go ahead, caller. We're listening to you.
Good afternoon, Zhivargo. Good afternoon, Laverne.
Oh, hey.
Good
how you doing?
Good. Peace and blessings to your families and to you guys. Zhivargo, I want to first say thank you for, you know, always bringing, you know, some level of intelligence and understanding to a lot of these topics. And while I can't say that I always agree with every point you make, you always try, I see your attempts to make sure that you're balanced and fair in your, you know, assessment and what you share. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Bob. But let me just say, I don't always agree with myself.
I understand. But listen, I just wanted to touch on the same subject that you guys are talking about, right, in reference to the, you know, the use of the energy and the ductless AC and your power bill. One of the things,
right.
I just to kind of qualify what I want to share, I was involved with a solar company some years back. It doesn't operate the same way it did, but I still kind of have a little touch to that industry. And what it brought me to was, you know, a lot of people talk about solar, but not very many people really get a clear understanding of the energy efficiency. So the LED bulbs you were talking about is a good step. The gas stove, dryer, and, you know, those things that we're going to talk about is also a good step. But one of the things that I don't think a lot of people take into account that's very influential on how your energy bill goes is insulation. So you may have heard that you need to get to, I think it's either zero or net zero pressure situation. What I really mean is that you need to make sure that you don't have your cooking or heat coming in or vice versa.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
When you have a door and you don't have a threshold at the bottom, you don't have the padding around the door frame so the air can escape, That will drastically affect your bill. One of the biggest escapes of energy in your house is through your ceiling. So, I mean, people would be I think, blown away when you see how dramatically your bill would decrease if you were to insulate your ceiling. Now, you could go the expensive way of spray foam insulation, or you could do a do-it-yourself thing like rolling out the insulation that is now asbestos-free. No one makes it with asbestos hardly anymore, and it's a much less expensive fix. But I can tell you, in my house, we'll sometimes feel cool air in our kitchen when we turn on the air conditioning in the room. And we want, you know, if you look at it, we have a hot tub in the bathroom, in the master bathroom. And so the cool air literally escapes under that hot tub and goes to the kitchen cabinet. So things like that, I mean, of course, we're resolving it, but of course, things like that, you may not even know that you're losing a lot of the broken windows where they don't close down all the way. Those are things that will drastically reduce your consumption of energy that aren't expensive as solar, for example. And as a matter of fact, even if you're thinking about getting solar, you have to focus on how you're using your energy. Other than that, you're going to be producing more electricity for you to waste. So I just wanted to plug that in there, because that's something that a lot of people don't consider when they think about solar and energy efficiency.
That's true. Thank you so much.
I was making notes.
And you know what is true too, caller, is one of the ways to know you got things seeping out is if find out where roaches and lizards and stuff are coming into your home. Because if they're crawling through your door, through the threshold, that means you have that space.
Yes. And so the air, if a roach could get in, how much easier and how much faster can air that's constantly flowing get in and out?
Exactly. And so, I have a front door that I used to have that issue with stuff coming in from outside. Because obviously when sometimes they're constructing these things, these guys leave some gaps. So they have some, it's like clay, like what kids play with?
Right.
Clay. So I just use that clay, and I just seal up the corners.
Yes. And certainly anytime you have operators that don't work, the windows that don't close properly, those things are very critical. But that ceiling insulation, that's one of the biggest factors right there. So people, I want people to understand, like, listen, if you're going to buy a new AC for a new room, try to get yourself the minimum of 18 SEER. SEER, S-E-E-R, is the rating, and the higher that number, the more efficient, the more efficiently it will run. So sealing up those cracks is a big factor as well in the ceiling.
I appreciate it very much, man. Thank you very much. We got a texter telling us right now, Florida prohibits SEERs less than 15 for items. So you're looking at, he just said around 18 and above, that's what you're looking for, right? So that's another thing to check for, Laverne.
I am making notes.
Yep. This text says, awesome show again, Mr. Laing. The SEER rating determines how energy efficient your unit is. The number, the more energy efficient your unit is, that also affects the cost of the unit. The higher the number, the more expensive it is. It will be. Keep up your great work, sir. Thank you. Actually, you know what I found is the ductless units are really cost effective. I'm not saying $600, $800 might be expensive for some people, but that's not unreasonable at all. Right. And one of the things I found is, Laverne, is when they install in the units, if you're not careful, that space between the wall, the inside and outside, where they run the wires from the condenser to the I forget what you call that unit inside. Sometimes they leave space. So you need to take a foam, something, and seal that up. Otherwise, lizards and other things that get in your house through it too, and you have escape of the cool. Right? So much to think about. Anyways, so Laverne, if you have a serial rapist contributing to a number of sexual assaults, then you can say, okay, we know what the problem is. We have to catch the serial rapist. But when you start having proliferation of sexual assaults across your islands, you're looking at some phenomena at work, I think. What do you think?
I agree. I was actually having this conversation yesterday, and that was one of the points that I made, that if there was a serial rapist, you And I'm not saying that that's okay. I'm just saying you can say to yourself, there's a serial rapist out there. I don't know if you recall, that was maybe last year or the earlier part of this year. I think it was last year, though, that we actually had, like, yeah, last year, we had a rapist here in Grand Bahama, right? Mm-hmm. There were two people or whatever that they were identifying a home invasion with sexual assault. And fortunately, they were able to catch them. But when you have this happening everywhere, there's no rhyme or reason to it. There isn't a particular type. It is just happening. We have a problem.
Well, the thing,
crisis.
The thing about it is, if the people who deal with these matters are correct, and that rape is not about so much the sex as it is about power and control, then amongst a segment of our male population, they seem to feel or see the need to flex some power and control. And so the question is, what's driving that?
Yeah. What is it that they are experiencing in their lives that, and I'm not making any excuses, but if we're going to stay on kind of that kind of thought, right? What is it that is happening in the other areas of their lives where they feel out of control or they feel they are not able to control? So now they are looking for a means of control to exert power because they feel powerless.
And this
is the means by which they are exercising some form of control, some sort of power, some form of domination. Is that part of it?
And the thing about,
just have some sick, violent people.
And the thing about it is, we're not talking about any group of people acting in coordination. There's across the island. So whatever is at play is less, for lack of a better term, is in the atmosphere.
Yeah.
Right? It's in the atmosphere that's producing this. So somebody asked me, did I think that it was because more of these people, more of the victims are willing to come forward? That's what they asked me. What do you
think about that too? Mm-hmm. I thought about that too. You know, initially I say, is this a situation where these incidents are happening? But women now are able, and it's more women than men, but let me just to be fair, victims now feel a bit more emboldened or empowered to speak up and to say, this is what I experienced. That may be it to some degree, but I also believe that there, something is going on. It's happening more frequently.
Mm. I agree. I agree with you because, and I say that largely because it's hard to explain that across the islands, you are having this happen, and it's because really more people are willing to come forward. Because,
right.
Well, unless you've done a really effective job at emboldening victims to come forward, then yeah, that could be true. But
right. And you know, when you think about it, because I started to kind of flesh it out, I started to think about, as a society, what has happened or what is happening that women or victims would feel more emboldened? Has there been any change in anything, really any significant change where you get that moment where you say to yourself, aha.
Yeah, no,
I can talk about it.
Was it legislation? Right. Was it education? Was it outreach? You know, what was it?
Right. And so that's why I said, perhaps there may be some, but I don't think that that's the overreaching thing. I honestly believe there's something going on. I don't know, like I said, if we've become more violent, just more vile. You know, we talk about power and people feeling out of control. And so you are looking for a way to dominate and control. and this is the way that you do it? Is it just really coming home that they're the view sometimes of the way that men see women, especially in cases where with women who are known to them? No boundaries. No, if she laughs with me, if she has two drinks, if I flirt with her and she flirts back, well, then automatically that means that this is going to turn into more. And so I am unable to process that. That was her threshold. And she's like, no, you know.
This, you know, you have a problem when the College of Bishops decide they need to meet on it, right? Because right. I got a note from Bishop Hanshaw, who was the chairman of the Bahamas College of Bishops, and he said, as members of the College of the Bahamas College of Bishops will meet to deal with the increased sexual assaults on our women and girls. This evil has come to an end. We are outraged and will do whatever is necessary to assist in resolving this vexing social issue. We cannot and will not allow these rapes and assaults to continue. Recommendations will be made and a plan of action will be implemented. Perpetrators should be dealt with swiftly and harshly. This is the College of Bishops, so you know.
Right.
And so moved, the problem is really elevated.
Let me ask you a question just for my own understanding and clarification. The College of Bishops is separate and apart from the Bahamas Christian Council, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah,
the fact that they spoke out, they were on a talk show last night, but they were just giving their personal views. They said that they would come out with a unified statement some point this week. But we should all be alarmed by this. You know, I was reading in The Guardian, you know, Michaela Barnett Ellis, Senator, and her expressions. And I agreed with her. She said that she changed her running route. I used to walk a lot, right? Yeah, I'd walk in the mornings. That was best for me. And there is trepidation. Uh-huh. Now I want to make sure that there are people on the road that I already see. Where before I would get up, I would go, there would be. No, I was vigilant. I'm not saying that I was careless, but there's that concern.
Of course. You have to adjust.
And I changed my route. I would go one. I had a routine, so I changed it up. And so you'll be hyper-vigilant because of what's happening in this country.
But brothers, listen to me, right? Brothers. The sisters could do it too, but I'm saying brothers. If you have a spouse who wants to exercise and do it outdoors, accompany them. If you're not going to walk or run, you ride a bike or you drive behind them, with them. That creates safety, right? If you say, I don't have a spouse, so you got brothers and sisters, you got uncles, you got a friend who's a mayor, take them with you. Because you're better to be safe than sorry. Because if somebody's out there who have no boundaries on their own life and therefore want to violate you, you don't need that. You don't want that. Additionally, you know, ladies, if you don't want to what you do with a guy, then a group of you do it, that's more likely to help. If you feel like you're in an area where many of y'all exercise or go or what have you, call the police. The community policing people told me, we are here to help. That's what they tell me. So if you, and this for males and females, if you feel unsafe, you feel blah, blah, you can call them, tell them, well, here's what's happening. Could you help me? Maybe there's a circulating thing you do in the area, so forth. Point being, listen, man, protect yourself, make adjustments.
Absolutely. We have to, we can't take it for granted.
Yeah.
You know, I had a friend who one time she used to be to her shop late, and she said she would literally call her, and this was many years ago, when she was at her shop late and there was like no more cars in the parking lot, when it was time to go home, she would call a taxi.
Mm-hmm.
He would call a taxi. The taxi driver pulls up. She comes out. Her car is there. She would give him money. She would tip him for coming.
Mm-hmm.
But just to have someone, you know, there as she's going to her car. And some people say that may seem extreme, but we are, to my mind, this is a crisis. We cannot take chances. We cannot take chances with our children.
Right.
We cannot even, you know, before you find, oh, they're just playing in the yard.
No.
You got to sit out there. You got to, if you can't sit out there, then they need to find a game. I know it sounds like all this, whatever. I'm not, you go with a play. I got to sit out on the porch. I got to be able to see you. Or you come inside and find something to do.
You going out to recreate? You going to join a club? You going to join a team? I want to find out who dealing with what
and yes.
Why. I'm not taking them chances like that.
We
right?
cannot take any chances. Yep. And then for our young men, again, and it seems like we're singling them out, but I'm saying for our young men, we have to teach them that no is no. I've said it before, I think, on a morning blend. My son and daughter, they're not here. They live away. But I remember one of the first things, I just happened to come on. I was visiting, and I just happened to come upon a conversation. And my daughter was going down a laundry list with my son. No is no. And she was creating different scenarios. And she had him repeating, what does that mean? It means no. Mm-hmm. And they say yes, but then they change their mind. What is that? It's still no. And I mean it, just coaching him. And some people may think like, okay, but get it in your head that no is no. It doesn't matter what they are wearing and all of that. Yes, there is a certain element. I'm not disregarding that. But at the end of the day, because you bought someone some drinks, because you two flirted, even if you two, what we used to call make out, if at any point one of those persons participating says, I no longer want to participate, as difficult as that may be, as vexing as that may be, as upsetting as whatever as that may be, respect that.
The thing about it too, I like to say to young men is understand your body. All right, I don't care how spiritual you is. I don't care who you are, okay? I don't care how religious you are. I don't care how decent your parents are and how much they raised you and how you go to private school or not. It doesn't matter. Our bodies as men have some hormones that when they kick in, it becomes very hard to resist your primal instincts. Very hard. So if you don't try not to put yourself in a situation where them primal instincts might cause you to not understand no is no.
Right.
But see, I mean, let's be real, right? I mean, so sometimes you end up on the beach with your person and you end up in the car by yourself with a person, you end up in a bed with somebody just by yourself with a person. You go too far. And sometimes you want to exercise control, but them hormones have hijacked your big brain and caused your little brain to cause you to end up one day standing in front of a magistrate explaining how you sexually assaulted someone. And who needs that? Right? Who needs that? Yeah, for a couple seconds, a minute, 2 minutes of pleasure. For you, but not for the person you assaulted. You may end up with a lifetime of challenges, incarceration, and that. You don't need that. So know your body, man. Work with your body. Don't mind all them brethren running on with nonsense talk, but use a little punk and all that kind of stuff. I tell people, you call me punk all you want. And my plans for life was never be in jail for rape or be dead before I turn 18 or 19 or 20 or 25 or 20, 30. Because you thought I was going to be a punk. Yeah, let me be a living punk who's successful enough to know what is appropriate to do and not to do. We're going to take our final break, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here talking with Laverne Gardner. When we're done, when we come back, we'll wrap up. You'll be back after this break. You're listening to Z Live.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to take a stand. Take a stand. Everybody, everybody, come take my hand. Come take my hand. We'll walk this road together through the storm.
It's It's Whopper Wednesday every Wednesday at BK NASA. Make your Wednesday sizzle and sink your teeth into a flame-grilled beef patty topped with tomatoes, fresh-cut lettuce, mayo, pickles, ketchup, and sliced onions, all on a toasted sesame seed bun with fries for only $5.95, including VAT. This Whopper Wednesday, grab a friend and head down to your favorite BK NASA location for a flame-grilled Whopper made your way with crisp fries for only $5.95. Burger King NASA, where taste is king.
Being an investor has its benefits, like the margin loan facility at RF. I can use my government bonds, company shares, and other investments to access cash when I need it, at a low interest rate of 7.5%, flexible repayment terms, and a 48-hour approval time. I can easily get the cash I need for travel, home renovations, or to purchase additional shares. This is just one of the ways RF keeps my money working for me. Learn more about the RF Margin Loan at rfgroup.com.
Boy, why you look so mashed up, like clothes at the washer?
No, boy, just a hard day at work.
Hard day? What happened? The breakfast lady ran out of tuna and gritsy.
You need to start joking with everything, you know. This serious, boy. This real serious, boy.
Boy, what's serious? Tell me.
All right, well, today, boss gave us boy one big, big contract. And nobody else get a chance and nobody say nothing.
Boy, you know that ain't right. You know government contracts ain't supposed to go that way.
Yeah, but nobody saying nothing. Boss man just tell people to sign the papers. Then he send me to meet his boy downtown and collect this envelope.
You need to tell somebody. You need to become a whistleblower.
You know I's a real man, but I never blow no whistle. I be drunk all my life in Junkano.
No way. A whistleblower is someone who tells people what they see when they see something wrong happening at work.
But I ain't no whistleblower, and I ain't no snitch. I still wait there, you know.
But ain't nobody gonna know it's you. All you gotta do is call Crime Stoppers, or you could text them from inside the Crack Crime Bahamas app. They don't ask about you, and your call goes straight through to Miami, so nobody know you is. And if you text, your message get mixed up like Kong Salad.
Call 328-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I'm not afraid to take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand, walk this road together.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host, here with Laverne Garden of Mixed News. We're here for these remaining moments of the show. Laverne, we got 5 minutes left. I'm going to read a text, and then I have some rapid-fire questions for you, right? This text is Laing. I totally agree with Laverne. This is a real crisis happening in our little Nassau, especially. We're at the point where we can't even afford to break down on the side of the road without the risk of being raped or robbed. And that goes for both male and females, because even males are being sexually abused. This is a crisis. So I have this is my first rapid question, fire question to you. What can the government do about increased rapes in the country?
Honestly, I'm not sure.
Yeah. Yes,
I'm going to be honest. I'm not sure.
You can try to ask the police to increase circulation in areas of vulnerability. You can do public announcements to try and warn and encourage the society to be more careful. You can have employers message to employees various cautions and various instructions. You could do that kind of thing. You can let your education system be more emphatic about the realities that's happening and see the extent to which they might be able to sensitize that community to things. But beyond that, you would pass more laws and say you can be restricted, send people to jail for life for rape,
Because the fact of the matter is, in creating these laws, we don't even want it to happen, to be able to have to use these laws, right?
You know what I mean? Right.
So a law is after the fact.
Exactly. So then the other question is, what can the church do?
The same things that you just mentioned that the government could do.
Mm-hmm.
Same kinds of things, talking to their congregation. Practicing safety and being aware and having more conversations, real conversations about the interaction between male and female. And yes, you're spiritual, but you're also physical. And having those kinds of conversation, and for girls, for boys, for women, men, you know, when couples, relationships, how we interact, you can do those kinds of things.
But it seems to me then that the bulk of what can be done to keep us safe has to be done by us. So what we can do is the biggest question, right?
That is the biggest question. What can we do? And, you know, all of the things that we mentioned about being so hypervigilant and all of that. But, Zhivargo, I want to say that there are people whose, you know, hearts are evil and they need a change. There are people out there, you know, you hate to think it, you hate to believe it, but there are people out there who are violent, who are evil, for whatever reason, take pleasure in inflicting harm on someone else, especially someone they see as more vulnerable or weaker than them.
Mm-hmm. And the thing about it is also, you know, some of us, you need to learn some defensive tactics. So even
go
to the police, go to security people, and find out some things that you could do to protect yourself in the event that you come up into somebody willing to assault you. And if that means you guys blind them, maim them, or something like that, well, that's the price they're going to have to pay for deciding to go down that road. But maybe some defensive teachings and instructions could be helpful and useful as well.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we are fresh out of time. Laverne, as always, thank you very much for always adding
always to a pleasure.
So this conversation. I appreciate you. Ladies and gentlemen, yes, ma'am, you've been listening to Z Live. I'm Zhivargo Laing, your host. I trust and hope you have a wonderful evening. God spares life. We'll talk to you again tomorrow.
I'm not afraid to take a stand, take a stand. Everybody, come take my hand, we'll walk this road together through the storm, whatever weather.
Z Live Off the Record with Zhivargo Laing is brought to you.